Okay, I think I'm live now. Apparently there's a button that says go live, and I thought I hit it, and then I unhit it, and I'm not sure. So if somebody could just message me on the side here and confirm that you can in fact hear me, I'd appreciate it. Thank you, Loretta. So my name is Justin Draplin. I am with Eclipse Cottages. I'm super excited to be here today. Hopefully you guys have been enjoying the show. Thank you for being here. Thank you to these guys for putting on the event. Thank you for all the other attendees. I'm really looking forward to this. So I have never done a presentation online like this before. So we'll see how it goes. But I'm super excited to discuss housing technology and tiny homes with you. So I'm going to share my screen here and go through a little bit of a presentation, if you will. And there we go. Okay, so let's start with this. So housing technology. Okay, I think that's working how it's supposed to be working. I'm not going to be able to see questions at the moment while I'm doing this. There might be a better way to do it. Zach, if so, call me and walk me through it, and I'm happy to do it that way. But we are a housing technology company. We are currently building tiny homes. My name is Justin Draplin. I was raised in Metro Detroit. Back up just a second. So why am I even going to tell you about myself? The biggest thing to me is tiny houses are ultimately about people. The reason that people like tiny homes or interested in tiny homes, it really boils down to people. It boils down to the people living in them, the people working on them, the people whose lives that they affect. Hence, I'll be starting with the introduction about my life and why I got into tiny homes and why I think the technology piece of tiny homes is so important to the movement. So again, my name is Justin Draplin. I'm from Metro Detroit, home of the big auto companies. Henry Ford was an influence on my life because I grew up so close. I had family that worked in the auto industry, were in the union. I saw that industry boom and bust, and I saw how it affected our family in both positive and negative ways. Growing up, I had a pretty normal childhood by today's standards. My parents were divorced. We lived with my mom. She did what she could to raise us, and she did a fantastic job. I got into a lot of trouble when I was a kid. I take that back. I stayed out of trouble, but really should have been in trouble. Don't ask me how that works exactly, but I was making some bad decisions. I did fine in school. I still don't know how I managed to do that. I ended up getting an internship at Morgan Stanley Dean Witter when I was in high school still. And this was going to be about the time that a lot of internet companies were going public. So I was working for a wealth management firm, and we had companies like Amazon, Pets.com, which didn't make it, eBay. Those were companies that were all going public at the time that I was working at Morgan Stanley. So it was very interesting to me because that was the most experience I had with all the technology that was coming up and how exciting that technology was. And I had it in an environment on the business side, on the, okay, these companies are IPOing, what does that mean? So that was like 18, 19 years old. I had a couple of years of internship there. I got into Michigan State University, go green. Michigan State University is an agricultural-based, it's a big school. There's a lot to it. They're very well known for the agricultural. They're also fairly well known for their business school. I went for their business school. They're green and white, so go green. I don't think that that's a coincidence. I think God forms our lives to get us where he wants us to be. So this goes to kind of my story, right? I was at Michigan State when Michigan State basketball won the championship. So it was an exciting time to be there. But going back to some of those bad decisions I started making earlier in my life, they got worse in college. I destroyed friendships. I really I really couldn't keep a friend longer than a semester. And I didn't really think it affected me a whole lot until after I graduated. And I got sober. So the date of my last drink was June 16th, 2003. And that's important to me because nothing else that has happened in my life since then likely would have happened. The biggest thing, meeting my wife, Jackie, she's an amazing woman. She would not have anything to do with me if I was still living the life I was prior to getting sober. And from that, we've ended up having four small children, ages 10, 8, 6, and 4. So again, to me, tiny homes is very much about people. I should also note that my dad was in the fire department and he built houses on the side. So construction has kind of gotten into my blood. My dad built maybe 30 homes or so growing up, and it was always something I was very interested in. So fast forward a little bit, business. What gives me a right from a business perspective to speak on tiny homes, housing technology, those kind of things? And once again, I'm trying to tie these themes together because I don't think they're separable. I don't think sustainability can be separated from tiny homes, which I don't think can be separated from the people, which I don't think should be separated from the work, which should... This needs to be looked at cohesively. And so my business background, Serene Surroundings, we did lawn care, landscaping, so outdoors, in the green, you know, making things beautiful from an outdoor perspective. I started City Drip, which was a digital signage company. So there we were, this was back in 2007, 2006. So back when digital signage was still fairly new. We were putting screens up in restaurants and connecting them to the internet and displaying advertising and information and all this kind of stuff. So you got kind of this outdoor piece, you got kind of the digital piece. And then I got started with Superfly Kits. I had a office for some a marketing company that I was doing, which was City Drip. So City Drip was, you know, digital marketing. And a lady was rolling out fabric in front of my door, and I'm like, what are you doing? She said, I'm making superhero capes. And I thought, well, that's cute, right? That's a cute little hobby. And I thought about it, and I couldn't get it out of my head. And the more I thought about it, the more I thought, like, superhero capes, like, that's kind of cool. And looking at it from a business perspective, I'm like, yeah, but could it be a business? And, you know, obviously there's 30 million kids under the age of 7 in the U.S. I'm convinced that everybody on the planet wants a superhero cape. It's just whether or not they're willing to admit it. So we were making custom superhero capes. And that whole concept was just so fun. Because it was about, we were doing custom. So it was about turning people into real life superheroes. Okay. It wasn't about being Batman or being Superman or Spider-Man or Wonder Woman or any of those people. It was about, okay, you too can be a superhero. And what does that mean? What does that mean for you? And we had a monthly subscription program and everything called Soar, where we were sending packages to kids. We had our own comic book, and it was like encouraging kids to be a real life superhero. And so a lot of it was standing up for your friends, protecting the environment, being a good neighbor, you know, those kinds of things. So this has all led me to a move that we made to South Carolina about 5 years ago. And again, we did it not because I had business down here, not because I had family down here. I didn't. But it was about our family now. I had a wife, and I had, at that time, I think 2 kids at that time. And my wife was from Austin, Texas, and we were in Michigan. And if for those of you that don't know Michigan, about 7 months out of the year are miserable. no offense to those of you that love snow and love cloudy days, but that just didn't do well for our family, especially my wife staying home. We homeschool our children. My wife homeschools our children. I do the best I can to support, but I mean, she's a rock star. Hands down, I married up, okay? So we moved to South Carolina and I'm like, man, I gotta do something. My businesses were still in Michigan. We moved here for our family just because we thought it was gonna be better to raise our family in an environment where we could take them outside, be in nature more often. I wanted to be close to the coast. So we moved to Charleston first. We're now in Greenville, South Carolina. And we love it here. So I found a piece of property just outside of Travelers Rest, South Carolina. Beautiful, gorgeous, 24 acres on the Swamp Rabbit Trail, which is a dedicated hiking and biking path that goes down through downtown Travelers Rest into Greenville. So 24 acres, a mile from this cute little downtown that was really growing. It's been voted best small cities in the country. Greenville's one of the best. We're only 20 minutes from downtown Greenville. And it was 20 acres and there's buildings on it that I could move my companies into. So I was like, okay, perfect. That'll work. But you know, it's 20 acres. What am I going to do with the other 20 acres of dirt? And as an entrepreneur, I was like, well, what are my options? And somebody turned me on to tiny homes. I was familiar with them. You know, I saw, the different HGTV shows and all this kind of stuff. And my first reaction was, well, that's cute, but there's no way that that could be business. Because again, you know, it was all about business. I mean, I'm an entrepreneur and I keep running things through that lens. I think I've gotten a little bit better about not doing that to some extent. But that's just where my mind goes, right? And so when somebody said tiny homes, my thought was, okay, you put a toilet in the kitchen and you have to climb up in a loft to go to bed. And I just thought, there's no way that that's a big market. It's a very niche market, niche, however you want to use that word. It wasn't a big market in my mind. Nobody long-term would want to live in that kind of environment. And once again, I had a very narrow view of tiny homes. It was the quirky stuff that you see on TV as opposed to, you know, really how would you take that and live your life like that? TV is very dramatized. So they like to take the quirky stuff and kind of just blow that up. So I kind of blew it off at first. Same thing I did with the capes. I blew it off at first, but I couldn't get it out of my head because I still like technology. I still like housing. And I ended up going into a home that was 399 square feet. And it had a bedroom on the main floor. It had full-size appliances, full-size bathroom, a living area, little laundry center. I mean, it was a livable space. And I went in one of them. And it wasn't the most beautiful unit. It wasn't, there are definitely things that could have been improved. But a light bulb went off in my head. And I said, wow, I could live this way. I think most people could live this way. And so we're on to tiny homes now. And it's like, okay, I've got a significant amount of business experience at this point. Okay, I've been exposed to construction through my father. I have remodeled my own. I added a bathroom to one of my houses up in Michigan on my own with the help of my dad. Have dabbled in technology, dabbled in, you know, how do you be a superhero? Been involved in landscape, yard maintenance, that kind of stuff. So do enjoy the outdoors. Part of my problem is I enjoy the outdoors when it's like 70 sunny with a slight breeze. So my wife gives me a hard time because I say I like the outdoors. And if it's like 80 and sunny and no breeze, I'm like hot and sweaty and I whine a lot. I'm a big whiner. I'm sorry in advance if you know me and you know that I whine a lot, but that's just part of who I am. I think I've also gotten better at that too. So now that we're on the tiny homes, I'm looking through the tiny homes through the lens of my work experiences, through the lens of my life up to this point and my experiences with owning a home, what would work for me and that kind of stuff. And so exploring tiny homes more fully was, okay, well, there's some good stuff about tiny homes. I saw the benefit of a small footprint. I think, you know, it can be taken a little bit to the extreme. I'm not a huge fan of 120 square foot tiny home to live in. God bless those people that can do that. I think I'd be a little bit too stir crazy. I know it can be done. I also have four kids. So my house is just insanely big for what I want right now, but it's kind of where we're at in our life for what we need. So tiny homes, what's good about them? I said, okay, well, tiny home people we're more focused on living your life, right? It's about a lifestyle choice. Again, I'm going to bring this back to people regularly. It's all of this stuff is about people. Lower bills, right? So financially, there's some benefits there of not buying a 5,000 square foot monstrosity. Obviously, a more sustainable when it comes to just the amount of materials, the amount of work it takes to build a home, the continual use of those materials, whether it's water, electric. Electric is a big one, right? That has so many repercussions. But that smaller footprint allows you to use less electric. And then once again, the materials. So, but what were the negatives, right? So there are some negatives with tiny homes, or some additional hurdles, some additional opportunities might be a better way to say that. I'm going to go ahead and change the slide and for the next presentation to call them opportunities. So the methods of construction. Now, I like that it, within the tiny home movement, there's a lot of teaching people how to do it, right? And it's because it's about the people, and I'm all for that. The problem is the more the advanced the technology, the harder it is for individuals to do it. Making your own tiny home is obviously very time consuming. So from a construction standpoint, it's a little overwhelming. You can take it step by step. You can take videos and all this kind of stuff. They could be more green, right? So because most people are building them themselves, we're still using 50-year-old technology, right? 2x4s. You know, most people are still using bat insulation, even though, you know, there's a lot of other options there. You know, siding, roofing, we're still kind of using the same stuff. And also from a technology standpoint, they're generally haven't been very advanced. There isn't smart technology going into a lot of tiny homes. I think, you know, that's starting to change, obviously. But the focus has been on, okay, the affordability piece, the tininess of the home. And even then, you know, the guys that started this company or this event with their old company, you know, were kind of innovators as far as making tiny homes really nice. Okay. Now it's like, hold on. We have this small footprint. We can actually make them really nice. So that kind of opened people's eyes to some additional opportunities within tiny homes. But like I said, this presentation, which I'm a third of the way through, and we're finally now getting to the technology piece and how that tiny home ties into tech. But I do believe that there is a need to kind of go through that process. And maybe I'm wrong. And, you know, if you think I'm wrong and you like the message, then you get to do the next presentation, because quite frankly, this isn't my spiel anyway. But the technology piece. So taking those things, my experience, tiny homes, what's the technology that I'm looking at? So here's just kind of a list, and I'll break them down a little bit more than what's written there. Sustainability. So this is going to be about a lot of things. Climate change is a big deal. Bear with me just a moment. Even with a small footprint, we can still be burning a lot of fossil fuels. You've got the sustainability from a construction standpoint. You know, we're using a lot of wires and metal, and a lot of that can be recycled. And you've got other plastics and stuff, and we can be using recycled plastics. And then it's, okay, how are we measuring this stuff? How are we measuring what's used? Like, so from an electricity standpoint, how much energy are we using? How can we reduce that use? And how is that, how can that be used across the board? Not just in tiny homes, but that the technology can be used anywhere. But this is where tiny homes become so important for all of these things. With a small footprint, it gives us an opportunity to test some of this stuff and not go crazy, right? So if we're building a 3,000 square foot home and we want to power the whole thing with solar, that becomes a really expensive test to do. When you break it down to 300, 400 square feet, suddenly it's a lot easier to test that out. And my argument is within the tiny home space, that's going to hold true across all of these technologies that we're going to touch. And again, bringing sustainability back to the people, right? I have four children. I want them to live in a world that is green, that has trees, that has grass, not concrete and skyscrapers. I mean, there's a place for a large city. There's a place for density. But I think there's a way to get a more density than the suburbs, but less impact, less packed in than a city. I think there's a happy medium there, and I think tiny homes fits into that well. But the sustainability of peace obviously affects people from a healthy standpoint. So our individual health, the home that we live in affects that to such insane degrees. You got two pieces to this. You got exterior and you got interior, right? So exterior to the home, there are things like pollen. You know, it's allergy season down here, which drives me crazy. I hate it. But it's a problem. So pollen gets into the home because homes aren't made well. They're made with all of this stuff just allowed to kind of come in. Dust, obviously, just collecting everywhere. That's, you know, that's going to come in through the home. You've got fire and smoke. So you've got forest fires in California, wherever, from these electrical problems, right? Some of this stuff all ties together, right? But then it creates all this smoke. That smoke can enter into these homes and take a while to come out. I mean, as long as that smoke is gone in that direction, you're now inhaling that smoke because the way we build our homes doesn't have that barrier. Moisture, you know, storms, those kind of things. From an exterior standpoint, you have all of those things exteriorly affecting us within our home potentially. And then interior, you also have the parts of the home that are affecting you from the interior. You've got off-gassing of the products that were used to make your home. You've got VOCs, volatile organic compounds. I think you can Google that. The potential for mold, mildew. And then from a usage standpoint, obviously, we generally all are getting water from our homes. So somewhere or another, that water needs to come into our home. How healthy is that water? You know, being from Michigan, I'm all too familiar with the Flint water crisis. I'm sure many of you have heard about that. But basically, it was a central water system, and we put in, not me, but the government or whoever put in lead pipes, right? And so all of these individuals, huge swaths of people were drinking poison, right? That's going to affect your health a little bit. And it's not just that where we put in bad infrastructure, but then you go to look at, okay, well, whenever there's a leak, whenever there's a broken pipe or some major storm comes through, you know, you get put on this boil water advisory, right? Because the water is now dangerous to you potentially. So there are these things somewhat outside of our control that affect us. And again, my argument is that tiny homes are the place to fix these things. And again, health, this is all going to affect people. It boils down to the people, the individuals that are going to be living in these homes, our neighbors, our friends, our family. This is what all of this is really what it's about. So smart. So the smart is more the technology, right? Automatic technology, being able to set your thermostat appropriately. So it will automatically shut off. Come on, you know, it'll drop it 15 degrees at night. Or whatever you need. It'll learn your patterns to reduce waste, to reduce usage. There are some opportunities with blockchain, and I get it, like it's power intensive, but if you look at some of that technology and how we could apply that into housing and ultimately save energy, because we can then track perhaps on the blockchain every single individual house and feed that database through a decentralized application to track those things. Track, okay, well, how much energy are these homes using? Where are the opportunities? Track whether or not that home has a vapor barrier on their exterior, because that could be letting in that pollen and that kind of stuff that we had talked about. So there's an opportunity there from a technology standpoint. Obviously, it can't just be any technology. We can't just say, blockchain, because it's the cool thing to talk about, and even though it burns a ton of electricity. Like, we have to look at technology, and it's meant for us to be used in a good way. So how can we take it, and is there a way to use it to make things more efficient so there is less waste? So can we get to the point where we're doing mortgages on blockchain? Okay, yeah, it uses energy, but I wrote mortgages for a little while, and generally you're getting a pretty good stack of paper that ends up getting thrown away. It seems pretty inefficient. Now, somebody needs to actually do the calculations on that. I'm not saying that is definitively the answer, but those are some of the things that we are exploring from a technology standpoint. When you get into the construction of a home, how they're built, the actual materials that they're built with, as I mentioned before, it's generally a slow, inefficient method. 2x4s, nails, it's done outside. It's not in a controlled environment. So there's a huge opportunity here. And being from Metro Detroit, you've got Henry Ford set up assembly lines, right? Where we could better control the environment that homes were built in. So again, tiny homes are like the perfect avenue to just keep exploring that. Like, how can we build this technology and build it in a controlled environment to make it safer, make it healthier, use the technology, use the smart technology to track the pieces that go into it. Where did they come from? So if something goes bad, we can more easily hunt that stuff down. And obviously, from a construction standpoint, how does it affect the people, right? The individuals. I mean, I've seen crazy people building houses. I mean, walking on the top of a wall to start putting up the floor on the second story. And I mean, there's definitely safety precautions that can be taken, but there's a lot of danger in just the way that we do the construction, site-built construction, and having to go to that site and all of the things that are involved with that. So technology, tiny homes to address construction is an issue. Financing. So you got mortgages, mortgage rates are going through the roof. I used to write mortgages. So having affordable financing is a big deal. Now, tiny homes, many of you know, are problematic. When it comes to financing. And that's another solution where the technology kind of accidentally helps with the financing. So at Eclipse, every single tiny home that we build has a solar roof. The other thing is that tiny homes, if they're built on a chassis and are considered either a trailer or a park model, qualify for what's called bonus depreciation. So by taking the technology such as a solar roof, which it is qualifying for solar tax credits, and it also has this depreciation that can be taken at the home, we can bring in investors and actually lower the financing options and create better financing options. Like, we are going to have a zero down financing option, but it's because of the technology and it's because of tiny homes. It doesn't work the same with a regular built, stick built home because it doesn't qualify the same way from a financial standpoint. Both get the solar tax credit, but being able to depreciate a tiny home the way that you can gives us an ability to offer these amazing financing opportunities. Like, there aren't really zero down or $500 down or $1,000 down tiny home financing at a reasonable interest rate. But if we're building using this technology, it becomes a lot more feasible, both through a reduced use of energy, which reduces our electrical bill, applying solar tax credits. So an investor can come in and this investor would get those, but it would allow for better financing options. And then through that reduced usage in an ongoing basis. And so the final piece of the technology in tiny homes that can be touched is the community aspect. Again, all of these are about people. So this is like the last one because it's like the people of the people, the group of people, if you will. So what I've seen, I've got over 900 tiny home lots in development all in South Carolina. And so what I've seen developing tiny home communities is the community piece. It's not just a small home in a space. It's the people that are coming and attracted to tiny homes. They want to live a good life. They want to get along with their neighbor. And we have people that disagree with each other and, you know, we have opposite sides of the political spectrum. But I don't see the news version of politics in our tiny home communities anyway. I see those polar opposites getting along for the most part. I mean, whenever you have a community, there's always some conflict of some sort. But these solutions coming together and being able to be in a community where you have your individual space, you're not sharing a wall, you have your own space, but you're still within that environment is kind of the ultimate part of the community and the people coming together. So this is why I think tiny homes and housing technology and the exploration of housing technology is so vital. The opportunity is just insane, okay? That's just from an opportunity standpoint, but from just a common sense applicability standpoint, tiny homes are where all of this stuff should be taking place. All of the innovation within these things should be taking place within the tiny home communities, the tiny home movement, the tiny home builders should be the ones focused on all of this stuff. And I think more and more we are. And some of the interesting thing, and I'll get into that in just a second here, is how these things tie together. So now it's part of the reason the financing options that I talked about work is because of how some of the other things I talked about tie together. So I kind of talked about that at the beginning, how it's important to go through all things kind of play together and they feed off of each other. And what we have right now is a lot of segmented people and businesses focused on different parts of these technologies. So you have, you know, Tesla. You know, they're very much focused on the sustainability. You could say they're focused on the smart piece of it. And then maybe construction, right? They're doing some stuff with the assembly line and whatnot. But when it comes to housing, really all they're doing is the sustainability part and they're helping with the construction because their solar roof is a full solar roof. You put it on and it's the whole thing. You don't have to put a roof on and then come back and put solar panels on. You have definitely businesses focused on some of the healthy things, water filtration, non-VOC paints, you know, those kind of things, smart technology, you got Google, Apple, you know, trying to do smart housing, you know, from a construction, you definitely have big builders, Pulte, and I forget some of the bigger ones, but they're still mostly constructing in a traditional method. They really aren't making changes. They're about like, let's just build stuff cheaply, as inexpensively as possible. And from a financing, there's been very little changes to the way a mortgage is done. There's different structures to a mortgage, and it's gotten us into a lot of trouble as well. But it hasn't really changed a whole lot. And then obviously from a community standpoint, you have definitely people focused on community, online community, and all that kind of stuff. But what I don't see is somebody that's actually taking all of these things and saying, how does that work together? And again, tiny homes specifically are the perfect avenue to start addressing some of these problems, which will have far-reaching consequences across the board. So it's going to affect not only tiny homes, but it'll affect all construction in cross industries. When you get into health, when you get into financing, it's going to be a big thing here. Now I'm going to slide this out of the way. Oh, let's quit sharing my screen for a minute. Stop streaming.